Oh, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Barnesville Baptist Church. Welcome everyone here. Welcome everyone online. First Sunday of February.
Right.
And yet, the last couple of days felt like February, too. But, just a couple of quick announcements. The Love Our Seniors Luncheon on February 14th. If you want to attend, what did I hear, 27?
Around 29.
Oh, great. 29. That's awesome. And then, so we got till today to see Cindy or Stephanie or contact the church or Pastor Danny or somebody to let you know we're coming. So we usually have enough food anyways. But Wednesday night, starting this Wednesday, a new study on 1 John. That's online and in person. And then on February 18th is the Duckpin Bowling at Mount Airy Bowling Lanes at 1 o'clock. So sign up in the church or contact the church about attending there.
Yeah, it's in the foyer.
It's in the foyer in the back of the church. So, any other announcements? Nope. Anita, you come lead us in our song.
Good morning, church family, here and online. Sorry. For those interested, National Christian Choir is having a program in Frederick tonight at 6. It's Evangelical Lutheran Church, 31 East Church Street. So if you're interested, you can let me know afterwards. I can give you more information about it. Today I want to ask you a question. What can you praise God for today? Whether it's God's grace and mercy, His love and compassion, His healing power, His greatness, or His presence right here today among us. Let's give God our praise. Join me in singing our call to worship, Praise Him, Praise Him, number 149.
Praise him, praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, and heaven.
Wonderful, all the way.
Hail, 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 highest.
Hebrews 13:15 says, through him, through Jesus, then let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that confess his name, the name of Jesus. John 15:15, Jesus tells us, I do not call you servants any longer. I have called you friends. Just as we are friends of God, Jesus is our friend and our guide. He is with us through our thick and thin experiences, even to the end of our lives. There's no other one like Jesus. No, not one. Join me as we sing number 152, No, Not One.
Before we go any farther, what a beautiful song. Amen. That chorus, I believe, sums up our walk with the Lord. He knows all of our struggles. He's never left our side. Today in Sunday school, we talked about Peter. And we talked about how the fear the disciples had in the boat. And Jesus came immediately. It's the first time you see the word again in this passage, immediately. Jesus left immediately, came to the disciples. Then Peter had a little faith, and he had faith to know that if Jesus, God Almighty, said, walk on the water, then he would get up and be able to walk on the water. But just like you and I, then Peter turned his eyes into the situation he was in. Amen. He turned his eyes towards the circumstances he found himself in, which was what? A raging sea. You and I have been there many a time. We find ourselves in a raging sea, and we at times, unfortunately, we turn our eyes away from Jesus. But what did Jesus do? He immediately reached out and he said, "Do not fear, take courage, for I am here." The I am is here. Then he immediately reached down his hands because Peter knew that his only salvation would be on through Jesus. In other words, Peter turned around and turned his eyes back to Jesus. And then Jesus immediately reached out his hand and pulled him up to safety. But then what did Jesus do? He got up and got in the boat. Then he immediately showed his authority. And the disciples reacted with what? Who is this guy that even the winds and the waves obey him? In other words, he is God. Who are we in the boat with? And you know what? Their faith was strengthened from that moment on. Why? Jesus immediately came. Jesus reached down, not in criticism, not in judgment, or nothing else. He taught the lesson. The lesson was coming. Amen. Every lesson comes. But he immediately reached his hand down out of love and rescued Peter. Then he got in the boat, just like he does with you and I. When we call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, he immediately reached down. Then he joins the situation. He's already there, but we get our eyes back focused on him. And he always shows his authority and gives the glory to the Father. Amen. And then we are strengthened. I say all that to say this. That course sums it up. Jesus knows our struggles. So let's stand. And Jan, if you could back up, you should have known where I was heading with this. I know that. Let's sing that course. And then Nita, we'll already be standing at that point. Okay. Let's sing that course with a different meaning in our hearts. With a gratitude and thankfulness that not only does Jesus save us, he knows us. He created us. You're going to hear this in a little while in the sermon. Jesus made us. Jesus paid for us. He made us. He paid. And now he's our Savior and Lord like he's always been. But remember this. Never take your eyes off him and look at the circumstance or the situation where we're going to sink. Always keep our eyes on the Lord. Amen.
Worship song is right out of scripture. Psalms 103:1 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." And Psalms 126:3, "The Lord has done great things, amen, and we rejoice." Amen. Let us rejoice today over the blessings God has given us and over the blessings God will give us in the future. Number 151, "Bless his holy name."
He has done.
Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day and this opportunity to come, both in person and online, Lord, to worship you and to bless your holy name. Lord, we just ask a blessing to be upon this service. Be with Pastor Danny as he brings your word. Be with all those that are watching here, all those that are watching online, all those that will watch it later on. Lord, we just ask for blessings and your peace to be upon each one of us, Lord, that comes to worship you today. Lord, we do lift up those that still may be sick and just need your healing touch or just need you to draw near to them today, Lord. We just lift them up. And Lord, we're thankful as we come later to your communion table. We remember the great sacrifice of your Son, Jesus, the greatest gift you could ever give, the salvation that comes through knowing him, through his body that was broken and his blood that was shed for the remission of our sins, not his sins, but our sins. And we're thankful for that, Lord, and we just ask your blessing on our service today. And the way your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me in the responsive readings and insert in your bulletin on the screen. I'll be reading John chapter 1, and then you got the responses will be from various Genesis, Proverbs, Psalms, and Deuteronomy. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. He was in the beginning with God. I have been established from everlasting, from the beginning, before there was ever an earth. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. Good morning. It's good to see everybody here this morning as we come to worship the Lord, and glad to see so many out today in God's house. Also, as Brother David said, I want to welcome everybody online also who is joining us and participates every single week. You're just valuable to us as everyone else. We do praise the Lord. We had our business meeting and worship committee. Luke, our chairman, informed us that our online services through January rose 30%, and that's beautiful, of our attendances. So we welcome all that just started watching or has come back to watch, and we give you the praise and the honor to the Lord for all that. Amen, as we come to God in all that we do. I couldn't help but to look this morning, and I'm telling you, these are beautiful flowers. Amen. I take for granted Kitty's work, and I mean that, and I take for granted a lot of people what they do in the everyday worship that we go about. Clean church, bulletins, a really nice responsive reading that was different. Lee did a good job of that. But the flowers, I mean, every week they're beautiful, but I just was drawn to these. So I want to publicly say thank you to Kitty. They're beautiful. Amen. Just truly how it does enhance our worship and everything we do and say. I'm excited. We have 29 seniors coming for our seniors lunch. We're going to have a hoedown. Amen. We're going to enjoy each other. We're going to enjoy some good food. I'm in charge of the desserts, and I ordered two different kinds. I won't be in charge next year, but I am this year. Amen. So We're going to have a good time. It's really about Christian fellowship. If you remember, we studied in Philippians the whole month of January about protecting and embracing the divine fellowship of the Lord. We're going to see things different. We're going to disagree at times, but the one thing we cannot ever, ever do is allow Satan to have a foothold or to allow the divine fellowship as Christian brothers and sisters to be hindered by nothing. Because Jesus Christ is the answer. Amen? He's the only one that's got it right, by the way, is Jesus Christ. So we just give the Lord the praise and honor for that. But I am excited. We have room for many more. I'd like to round her off at 30. So if we can get one more, or 31 might even be better. It's not about numbers. Boy, it's about fellowship in the Lord Jesus Christ and about enjoying each other. And a good meal is the blessing. Amen. As we move forward, pray for Billy this week, Appleton. We're going to see the doctor on Friday. We take our monthly ride and get our breakfast and our coffee. And we solve the whole world's problems, Billy and I, on the way down and back. So if you've got a problem, let us know. We'll solve them, all right? We'll tell you exactly what we think about it. And all kidding aside, we pray, Billy and I, every time before he walks in, he'll come out for good report. Amen? And the Lord has blessed him. We're just grateful for healing power of the Lord Jesus Christ. So all that being said, we thank you. We had a good January. God met our needs. But guess what? It's February. So be faithful to the Lord. Be faithful to all that you're doing, and God will receive the honor. Amen? Eddie, lead us to worship in our tithes.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, awesome God, what a glorious day you've given us. We thank you for the many blessings on our homes and our family. We thank you for Barnesville Baptist Church. We thank you for everybody who's attended today and those that are watching online. We thank you for Pastor Danny and Cindy. We thank you for every good and perfect gift that you've given us, Lord. Now, we give back to you a portion of everything you've given us in our tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jim. That was lovely. Please rise for our doxology.
Amen. Thank you, Jan. That was beautiful. You had us all singing along with you. So, because he lives, what? We can face tomorrow. Amen. All right, Brother Bill, it's time for children's story. You come on up, and children online, gather around the computer and join us as we look at God's message for today.
You're in the cold? Well, that's good. Got a question for you. In Luke 14:11, Jesus said, "Everyone who makes himself great will be humbled, and everyone who humbles himself will be made great." What do you suppose he was talking about when he said that? You have any ideas? Well, I'm going to try something and show you something maybe that you'll be able to realize what he was probably talking about. And I need a balloon to do it. So I got one right here. If I got enough wind to blow it up, I'll show you. I need some hot air. Elnora? Okay. Well, I'll show you what I'm going to do with this balloon. Do you know that a balloon is... that we're like a balloon sometimes? People are like balloons. Did you know that? Yeah. Sometimes we get all puffed up with our own importance. We think we're very important. So this is what we're going to do. I'm going to blow this balloon up a little bit, if I can. Okay. There it is. We think we're great, and we expect everybody else to think we're great, too. Do you think we're great? I think I'm great. We're getting puffed up now, aren't we? Yeah. Maybe we think we're great because we're so good-looking. You think that's it? That could be it. You don't think so? Oh, you don't think I'm good looking. You think you're good looking. No. Getting puffed up more. Maybe we think we're really good at a sport. We're so much better than everybody else. You know, I must be good. I must be great. I think I'm the smartest person here. That's just how great I am. I'm getting really puffed up now. But what happens to us when we get all puffed up thinking just how good we really are? What do you think happens? Well, somebody will come along and pop our balloon. Just like that. Jesus warned us about that. Sooner or later, if we keep getting all puffed up ourselves, thinking how good we are, thinking how important we are, somebody's going to come along and pop our balloon. Jesus warned us that this would happen. The Bible teaches us that if we are too proud to think and think too highly of ourselves, we're headed for a fall. On the other hand, if we're humble, and realize that it's through God's strength that we're able to do great things, we'll be given a place of honor in God's kingdom. So what Jesus was trying to tell us was, we need to give credit to God for all of our abilities. Amen. If we're good at sports, we need to thank God for that gift. If we're really good singers or performers, that's not us. That's a gift from God, and we need to recognize that and not think it's us. We cannot make ourselves great. Only God can do that. Only God can give us those gifts. And we need to give the praise and thanks to Him for that. It's really impressive to me. I like to watch football on TV. And a lot of professional football players, when they do something really superhuman, like they make a fantastic touchdown, where they throw a pass that's just amazing. If you watch, they give thanks to God for that gift because they realize it's not them. That gift was given to them by God, and that's who gets the praise. And that's what Jesus was trying to tell us. Don't think so much of ourselves. Don't think that we're so smart, that we're so good-looking, or that we're so good at anything, because gifts all come from God. And that's the lesson to be learned. So let's pray together. Jesus, help us to be humble. Remind us that whatever abilities we have are a gift from you, and that you are the one who deserves the praise. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. You may have a seat. Wonderful lesson. Bill's got some lungs on him. Amen. Oh, wonderful lesson. I'm going to say this before we start in our word today. Earlier this morning, Luke showed me a video clip on Tim Tebow. Tim, is that his name?
Yeah.
Tebow. That sounded wrong. He's a Christian football player, quarterback, running back, baseball. Pretty much everybody knows who Tim Tebow is. And he was given a lot of gifts by the Lord, and he uses them even to this day, sharing the gospel and using the platform that God gave him to share the gospel. But there's a little clip that I'm going to ask Luke to download to our Facebook page or somewhere, or you could just text him; he'll send it to you. It's Tim Tebow sharing or the gospel in some school or something of that nature, or college, talking about John 3:16 that he wrote under his eyes, just like football players do. And if you don't know that, he wrote John 3:16. He used to write Philippians, but he changed it to John 3:16 before the national championship game in college. And then he carried that on throughout his professional career. And when he went in his first playoff game against the Pittsburgh Steelers, after the game, he still gives more testimony about this saying, John 3:16. Millions and millions and millions of people Googled John 3:16. I'll tell you that right now. So he doesn't give the glory to himself, which is why I like him. He gives all the glory to the Lord immediately and throughout. But it really is a very nice little clip. And so if you like to have that, it's just encouraging. It's not long, but it's really interesting what happened after that playoff game. With that John 3:16. It's just sometimes the smallest messages are the most powerful. Amen? So that's how God is. Bill, thank you, and thank you to all the ones that do Children's Story. It's vital for them, but you know what? I saw a lot of adults leaning forward and listening too. So we give God the praise. Amen? Let us pray. Lord, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for your holy word. I thank you for the opportunity I have today to share your word. Lord, forgive me where I failed you. Forgive me where I've allowed my emotions to get in my way. Forgive me for not being everything you want me to be at all times. Make me right, Lord. I can't stand in this pulpit today and preach your word unless I'm right with you. So I ask you even now to forgive me, to strengthen me, to heal, to make right, and not let Satan have a foothold at anything in any way to disrupt the beautiful work of this good body. Lord, empower me to be your servant in all that we are. As failed, as flawed as I am and as all of us are, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you just long for us to call on you. You don't give us a list of our failures. You reach out your hand. And I say, to God be the glory, great things he has done. And all God's people said, amen. Today we're starting a new study in God's word. And it's going to be found in John chapter 1, 1 through 18. And we're going to focus today on verses 1 through 5. We're going to be looking for the next couple months at the person and the nature of Jesus Christ. The person being fully God, full deity, yet fully man. We're going to look at his powerful works that he did here on earth and that he continues to do before he came to earth and as he is now in heaven with the Father. We're going to look at Jesus as the blessed, fully God that he is, and all the works that he has done and all the blessings that has been done through his name. Our study will start today and most likely will run us probably through Easter as we celebrate. And my prayer is, and I believe the Lord has laid this on my heart, with a clear message to prepare all of us, starting with myself, for the Easter celebration service. Amen. Before we come to Easter, I want us to know who this Jesus is, all that he's allowed us to see and to look. And to be able to do that, we're going to concentrate in the next couple months on four books today of the Bible. John 1, 1 through 18 will be this week and the next couple weeks. Then we're going to move to Hebrews chapter 1 and 2. And from there, we're going to look back at Philippians chapter 2, 5 through 11. We won't spend a lot of time there because we just spent a month on that chapter, but we will go back to that as a refresher. And then right before Easter or at the end of March, we will finish up with Colossians chapter 1 and 2. So there's your notes. You can read Hebrews, John 1 through, read John chapter 1, period. Read Hebrews chapter 1 and 2. Read Philippians chapter 2 and read Colossians chapter 1 and 2. If you do that along with our study, you'll come more prepared to hear and to receive the message that God has for you. What is beautiful about the Word of God is the application is different for every one of us. The theme, the main reason, the main text is always the same. It's God's spoken word. And when we look at a text, when we look at a scripture, when we look at a book of the Bible, one of the first things we should say to ourselves is, what is this passage saying about God? What is this passage saying about God? But look, did you notice I didn't say, what is this passage saying about me or my neighbor? Is what is this passage telling me about God? The other thing to remember as we look at God's word is that we should ask ourselves, what is this message, what is this text, what is this book telling me I should do to bring more honor to God? What is this passage telling me personally? Again, not your neighbor, not your co-worker, you. It all starts with our relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. If we're going to grow, if we're going to be strong, it starts with our relationship. So what is the passage saying about God himself? What is this passage telling me from God, what I ought to do? And then thirdly, what is this passage telling me that I should demonstrate or teach or share with others? Did you hear me in any of that except in a personal self? No, it's all about us. What you didn't hear is them or us, except for teaching and demonstrating. We can't teach, we can't demonstrate, and we can't be a living example until we've applied it to ourselves. Amen? Until we are all that we can be in everything that we are. So as you look at all these chapters and all these verses, keep that in mind. What is it saying about God? What is it God telling me that I should be, or what I should look at, or what I should change or grow stronger in? And what is it that I should be doing to share this good news? Because our word, our job as Christians is also to evangelize, to share the good news of Jesus Christ. So anyway, we're going to start in John chapter 1, 1 through 18. But I want to pray and ask God to bless our time together once again. Lord, as we laid out this outline that you've given me, Lord, you are God and you can change anything at any time. But I think it's great and awesome that we can learn more about you, Jesus, that you allow us to see more of you. May Danny Moore represent you in every thought, word, and deed. And may I bring honor to you, Jesus. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the things I want us to remind ourselves and to be excited about as we prepare ourselves for Easter, these passages, when we look at about Jesus and who he is, we're going to see a humble God. We're going to see a humble man. We're going to see humiliation. We're going to see joy. We're going to see compassion. We're going to see patience. That's the things that you see when you look at Jesus, how he humbled himself. How he always reached out his hand with the thought process of reconciliation. Not for revenge or not to be right or not to stand on the high and mighty that we all do. It was for reconciliation. It was to draw people back to Him, to the Father. It was for redemption. It was salvation. And He said it over and over again in His Word. Jesus said, for the honor of the Father God Almighty, to bring honor to Him. So I pray that as we prepare for Easter, and you might say, goodness, you're talking about Easter. Do you realize Easter is 2 months away? I mean, that's all it is. I think it's April 9th. It's right at the beginning of April. I know that. So we need to get ready for Easter. Amen. We need to prepare ourselves spiritually to celebrate one of the greatest days that we celebrate on a calendar, Christmas and Easter. Amen. Without Jesus, those days mean nothing. They mean nothing. Jesus was and is and will always be active in our lives by providing and sustaining and teaching us. That's why I shared with you what I did earlier about Peter. I wasn't just sharing the Sunday school lesson, even though I did. Jesus took the time to rescue Peter. He acknowledged Peter's faith by giving him the ability to walk on the water. He forgave Peter for turning his eyes from him. He rescued Peter, and he got in Peter's boat. He gave the Father the glory. He showed his authority, and then he taught a lesson. Can I say something from the bottom of my heart? Church, hear me, please. We can never teach a lesson until we've learned it ourselves. We have no right to teach a lesson unless we have prayed about it and examined our own lives and know that the reason we're teaching it is for growth, is to edify the Lord and to protect and to grow the divine unity of the believers. We can't teach something we don't have. Jesus gave Peter strength. Jesus rescued Peter. Jesus forgave Peter. Jesus got in the boat with Peter. Jesus showed Peter his authority. And then, when Peter fully knew who he was dealing with and who was in the boat with him, then, out of love and respect and reconciliation, he taught the disciples. God is good in all that he does. Jesus is our hope. Jesus is our salvation. Jesus is our everything. One of the things the writer said in Sunday school, and I really loved it, and we shared it in our class, and we really enjoyed that part of it, I know, was Jesus. When Peter immediately called on Jesus, when he was sinking, Jesus. Now, before we get on Peter, remember, Peter did get out of the boat. He did have faith. Amen. And he did walk. Let's give Peter a little good credit on the way. But then he turned his eyes and looked at the situation or inward or whatever you want to call. He allowed his fears and his selfish thoughts and desires to take over. And he sank. The word says that Jesus reached out his hand when Peter called immediately. He didn't give him a list of his wrongs. He didn't quote the things that could help him along the way. He didn't take that opportunity to teach him a lesson. Jesus rescued him. Jesus loved him. Jesus showed his authority to him and his compassion towards him. Then Jesus taught him. Can I tell you something? The lesson's going to come. Amen. We're not going to avoid that. But it's going to come when we'll receive it the most. Amen. God is so good. I say all that because I am grateful that's how God treated me. I am so grateful that the Lord taught me after I realized who He was. Amen. And the joy of embracing Him. And that's really what we're talking about today first. So let's start out with our passages, verse 1 through 5. And let's get a clear picture of who this Jesus is before we even start this study. John 1, 1 through 5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was the Word being Jesus. His Word, He was with God in the beginning. Through Him, Jesus, all things were made. Without Him, Jesus, nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Can I get an amen? What a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ. This person of Jesus, fully God, fully man, our Redeemer and Savior. As we look at the person of Jesus, I want to remind ourselves right from the very beginning how awesome it is. Please hear me. How awesome it is that Jesus allows us to know anything about Him. That Jesus' desire is that we would know Him personally. What a, we miss that at times. Christians, we get caught up in our own selves, in our own pride, our own ego, our own thoughts of what's right and wrong. Let me tell you something. It's a privilege to know anything about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a privilege to know that when you call on the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit indwells us with the power, and we not only have a personal relationship with Him. Come on, church. Jesus got in our boat, and He lives with us. He shows His authority. He shows His compassion. He surely is patient, but He always teaches also. Amen? Why? For us to grow and to know more than Him. So before we even get any farther, let's realize it's a privilege, it's a joy to even know anything about our Lord Jesus Christ. And yet Jesus pours Himself into us so that we can know Him, so that our relationship will be what, church? Personal. Unique, one of a kind. So I want to remind us all that we should start out this study with a heart of gratitude, to be grateful that we can know anything about Jesus in the first place, and to be grateful that Jesus does not look at our past. He doesn't even look at your present. He reaches down and says, "Take my hand." Take courage. Do not be afraid. I am is here. I am is here. One of the things we really embraced in Sunday school was the disciples. Put yourself there, church. Man, the storms were overtaking the boat. Jesus came walking on the water. Peter got out of the boat and walked on water. Peter turned his head and sunk, and Jesus reached his hand down and picked him up out of the water. Then Jesus got in the boat. Now, before you know it, Jesus calls on the authority He has, and the wind and the waves obey Him. You can't tell me that you're not sitting there going, "What just happened? Wow, who is this guy that even the winds and the waves obey Him?" In other words, He is God. He is Jesus. He's here with me. When you call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, the Holy Spirit indwells within you, the Trinity, the third person of the Godhead. Jesus now gets in your boat. And He never leaves you. He never abandons you. And He's patient. Wow. Man, we could stop there, amen, and give God the praise. But we're not. We're going to move on because you have another half an hour to hear about God's Word. John 1:1 says it all. In the beginning was the Word, being Jesus, and the Word was with God, being Jesus, and the Word was God. Let's break that down. First, we see that Jesus is divine in His person and His nature, fully God, fully man. John 1:1, it says it very first in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word. Hear me on this. We see right off the bat that Jesus pre-existed, and He as well continues to exist. Let me say it again. Jesus pre-existed and He continues to exist. He is eternal. He is God. He is always with you. Jesus is fully God, co-equal, co-eternal, co-existent. He is fully God, fully man, and He longs for you to have an experience personally and walk with Him. To walk with this co-equal God, to this co-existent God, to this co-eternal God. He doesn't land in the heavens above and you have to approach Him with works and deeds and all these other things that the world and other denominations and you and I put in the way. The Lord does none of that. He says, "Believe, confess, and acknowledge, and you shall be saved. You shall be my child." And then we're to grow. And he will show himself more and more who he is in our lives, every moment of every life of our lives, if we just take it in and realize he was pre-existence and he continues to exist. He is co-equal. He is co-eternal. He is co-existent and he is fully God. Can I get an amen? That's who Jesus is. And yet he wants to and longs and desires to live in our lives, to make us who we are. That's why we can't judge anyone. That's why we can't condemn anyone. There's only one righteous, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one authority, and that's the entire Word of God. Not pieces of it, the entire Word of God, the full counsel of God. And it's our blessing to know that. It's our blessing to even experience that. It's our blessing to be able to experience Jesus. He didn't have to. He didn't have to come to heaven and to earth. He didn't have to die on the cross and bear the greatest punishment and the greatest worst thing that ever could happen to anyone. That's with God the Father having to turn because he bared our sins. But the God the Father said, arise. Come on, we're getting ready for Easter. Jesus died. There's a reason it's called Good Friday. I'm sure there's a technical reason. Ask Lee, he'll tell you. But I can tell you what the street boy's reason is. It's Good Friday because that's the day he died for my sins. Amen. And Easter's celebration day because God rose him from the dead. We are dead in our sins and our trespasses because we're in Jesus Christ as believers. And because we're in Jesus Christ as believers, we're also risen to new life because of Jesus. Give God the glory. Amen. So let's read that first two verses again of John 1. In the beginning was the Word, Jesus, and the Word, Jesus, was with God. And the Word, Jesus, was God. He was with God in the beginning. John's just trying to make sure we all understand that. Amen? That he is who he is. It's a literal picture, an idea. Can you remember the picture of this? It's a literal picture of being face-to-face. That's what part of that Greek translation is. It means face-to-face, to be literally face-to-face to God and Jesus, to be united. Co-equal, but in full harmony. Boy, that's a big step. Amen. We're also to see a clear picture of Jesus' deity. Because in John 1:1, it says again, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Now focus on this, the deity. And Jesus, and the Word, Jesus, and the Word, which is Jesus, was God. Jesus has always existed. Jesus is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and that Jesus was with God the Father, and again the Scripture, and the Word was with God. So let's read it again. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Clear picture of Jesus' deity. Amen? Fully God, fully man. Well, that's a lot to take in if you really think about it. That's why you have to read the Scriptures yourselves, people. That's why you have to study it yourself, church. Because in 30, 40 minutes, we can't take in all God's counsel. It takes all of us to read the Word and to apply it and have application to our own life. Not to apply it to others, apply it to us. And then we're to evangelize, yes. No question about it. Then we're to share in the name of Jesus Christ. Then we're to love in the name of Jesus Christ. All these truths are meant to give you and me the confidence that we need to have, knowing we have a personal relationship with the full God Almighty, Jesus Christ, who dwells within our soul as believers through the Holy Spirit. Can I get an amen? There's nothing greater. There's no greater news. Church, it's not about being right. It's not about being angry or sad or disappointments. It's not about our past, what we've done. It's not about how we reacted to things or how we've hurt others. We all hurt each other, especially in our families. It's not about the sins we regret and we wish we could do over. It's about our personal relationship with the absolute, true, Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. It's about us being better today than we were yesterday. How I can be better today than I was yesterday. How I can experience more Jesus today than yesterday. And how I can be the living testimony that God requires me to be today. Better today than I was yesterday. Please hear this. There has never been a time when Jesus was not fully God, and there will never be a time when Jesus is not fully God. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega. Let me say it again. There has never been a time when Jesus was not fully God, and there will never be a time when Jesus is not fully God. In other words, Jesus has always been fully God and always will be for all existence. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He is the final say of all things. He is the living God. He does sit at the right-hand side of the Father. He does intercede for you and I daily, and He is just in all His righteousness. Amen? We got a little picture of who Jesus is. Amen? Picture of who He is in all things. We see Jesus is divine in His relationship with His Father also. John 1:2 said He was with God in the beginning. We can see that Jesus was in His eternal, and Jesus was with the Father. Again, He was with God in the beginning. We can see Jesus' position also. His position. He, Jesus, was with God. Now, one thing I want us to understand is this. Jesus and the Father are distinct. But remember the Trinity. The Father. The Son. The Holy Spirit, all distinct, but all in perfect harmony. Why is all things right in heaven? Please hear me. Because there's perfect harmony. God the Father sent God the Son, who died on the cross for you and I, to make a way for us to be right with the Father. And God, the Holy Spirit, equips us, empowers us, and teaches us, and reveals the Word to us. In my seminary class that I'm very much enjoying, one of the things the professor has said over and over again, the Holy Spirit interprets the Scriptures and reveals them, not you and not me. Let me say it again. The Holy Spirit interprets Scripture. He gives us the wisdom to know what it is. He gives us the strength, the ability to learn it. But when it comes down to it, it's God's spoken word. Amen? And if it's His spoken word, He has the one to tell us what it meant, how to apply it, and what the overall theme is. Which, by the way, I'll give you hints, redemption and reconciliation. Amen? Truly, God is awesome. God's word said, He, Jesus, the Word, was with God. We also see Jesus in His divine and His creation. Verse 3, we see Jesus and His deity, and He's divine in creation. Through Him, Jesus, all things were made. Without Him, Jesus, nothing was made that has ever been made. We see how Jesus was divine in His creation. John is sharing with us today that God's holy word that Jesus was and still and always will be involved in creation. Creating, sustaining, paying for it, providing for it, and walking with it. And then the greatest ever that He ever created in His own image was you and I. All things, everything that's ever been created is not only created by Jesus, but hear me, sustained by Jesus. I love how Jesus' word emphasizes the truth about Jesus. Without Him, Jesus, nothing was made that has ever been made. Jesus, fully God in His deity and creation, is divine. And now I believe these next two verses are really powerful and beautiful. So hear with me and stay with me a minute. Jesus is divine in His manifestation too. He's divine in His manifestation, referring to both Jesus' work in creation and His work in salvation. About Jesus and His work and His blessings of creation and salvation. Verse 4, Jesus says, God's word said, Jesus is our life. In verse 4, it says, in Him, Jesus was life. And that life was the light of what? All mankind. Verse 5, we see that Jesus is that light. The light shines in the darkness, and we see that Jesus conquered sin. And the darkness has not overcome it. I mean, that should really bring confidence to you and I. To know that with Jesus in our lives, if Jesus is our Savior and Lord and Redeemer, with us being believers and being baptized, baptism doesn't save you. Baptism is the outward expression that Jesus, I'm buried in my sins and I came alive in Jesus Christ. It's an screaming, beautiful, powerful testimony to all mankind, but also to yourself, that I was buried in sin and I'm alive because of Jesus Christ. I am risen because of Jesus Christ. Why? Because darkness has not overcome him. Come on, church. These truths should get us up on our feet shouting Jesus. We should act like we're a little Pentecostal maybe once in a while. Amen? And get rolling. I have to hold Larry down all the time. But I try my best to keep him. I make him sit on his hands. Amen? But you know what? Seriously, all kidding aside, what I love about all of us, whatever denomination is that believes in the saving grace of Jesus Christ, we are not ashamed of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And we all worship in our own mighty way. I enjoy this style of worship, or I wouldn't be here. I believe worship comes from our thoughts, our actions, our deeds, and our outward witness. Amen? And how we interact with each other. Here's a quote. I mentioned it earlier, but it's from Professor Ken at Southeastern, where I learned just this week. I really liked it. Jesus made it. Jesus paid for it. Jesus made you and I. Jesus paid the sins for you and I. And he did it while we were what? What's the word? Yet sinners. When we were still far from being his child, Jesus created us. Then Jesus paid us. You don't think there's love in Jesus Christ? Create something you know you're going to have to die for without a doubt. I might say willing to die for, that you know you will have to die for. Create something you know is going to abuse you your whole life. I don't know. I mean, maybe we did do that a little bit. I don't know. But seriously, think of this. Create something you know is going to abuse you, disappoint you, walk away from you, abandon you, and that you're going to have to die for them with the true desire of reconciliation to be the Father's plan was from the beginning. Pure fellowship. Honor. Exalting the Father. Next time anyone doubts Jesus' love for anything, remind them Jesus made us and he paid for us. There's no greater example of love than that. All the way to Calvary. Amen. We're getting ready for Easter. Amen. We're going to go to Calvary on Friday, and we're going to go to an empty grave on Sunday, and we're going to celebrate the whole way. Lord willing, let me put that pastor role little word in there. We never know what the Lord has for us, amen? But Lord willing, that's our plans. Jesus is life, and he's also the healing power. So in closing, my question is, do you know Jesus today? Have you experienced the Lord Jesus Christ personally yourself? Have you called on the name above all names? Is he the reason you do everything you do? Never let anything hinder your walk, church. Nothing. Don't harbor anger or sadness or disappointments. It's not worth it. It robs you. It robs you of your worship. Confess it to God and give it to God. Jesus says that over and over again. Lay your burdens here. Let me have them. You're just robbing yourself of joy. You're robbing yourself of blessings. You're robbing yourself of the opportunity to demonstrate in a living fashion the living God, Jesus Christ. Confess it. Ask for power to have love and compassion and patience. And then move on. In the name of Jesus Christ. Never stop praying for reconciliation. Please, never. Never stop praying for healing. Never stop praying to make things right. and never stop praying that the Lord will bind Satan and not hinder anything in your life or mine. If we do that, I believe we'll have a Lord who looks down and smiles upon us. Amen. And says, well done. Well done, my good and faithful servants. And that really is the goal. Well done. Well done, my good and faithful servants. Let us pray. Lord, I thank you for who you are, and I thank you for your love and your mercy. Thank you for your goodness and for your salvation. I thank you that when we do fail, and we all do, I thank you that when I failed, even this week, and allowed Satan to have a foothold in my thoughts, that you immediately took them away and replaced it with reconciliation, prayer, and pure love. There's nothing I want more than to have harmony and peace and to see you exalted. That's all I want. You have done so much for me. Not just saving me, which is the greatest thing you ever did for me, but you've embraced my family. You've given me this great church body to shepherd. You've given me the greatest job I could have on this earth. You've given me the ability to preach your word from your pulpit. You've allowed me to baptize your children. You've allowed me to see my grandchildren come to know you. You've allowed me to see my son and daughter grow strong in you. You've given me a mate, a best friend in my wife, Cindy, who stands by my side for over 40 years now. You have never left me. You have been in my boat from the day I've called your name, and I am a grateful man this day. To God be the glory. My prayers, I will never fail you. I will, and I have. But thank you that you immediately reached your hand down to Danny and said, take my hand. I am the I am. I pray everyone here and everybody online knows you, Jesus, as their Savior, Lord. If they don't, all they have to do is in their heart confess, Jesus, you are Lord. In their heart, confess that they are sinners. To confess with their mouth that you are Lord Jesus Christ and that they need you, to ask to have you forgive them of their sins and acknowledge that God raised you from the dead. In other words, believe, confess, and trust. And you said, you shall be my child. You shall be saved. To God be the glory. And all God's people said, amen. If you don't know where you stand with the Lord Jesus Christ, don't let a moment go by today without being right with the Lord. Call, email. If you're struggling with something, my email is on there, PastorDanny@live.com. It's private. No one reads it. Text me. Whatever the case may be, provide. Reach out. If you need to be baptized, reach out. If you want to be a member and be part of this family, reach out. Whatever it is you long to do, don't let fear keep you from it. Step out in faith. Amen? Follow your heart. Follow the guidance of the Lord Almighty. Before we go any farther, I do have to say we need to pray for our state convention, the Baptist Convention of Maryland and Delaware. The executive director that just started not too long ago, Michael Crawford, as you've seen on the videos, he resigned Friday night immediately due to sin in his life. The convention is hurting. The convention is in sad shape. The convention, Satan is trying to intervene and destroy the good work of the gospel in the Southern Baptist Convention right here in our Maryland, Delaware convention. But can I say this from the pulpit? There's a lot of good, godly people working at that convention right down here in Columbia who are preaching and teaching and sharing the word of God. One man doesn't rule anything. Can I say that again? Only Jesus. One man can fail and hurt can come from it, but he doesn't rule anything. Jesus does. So pray for the ones, especially Tom Stoll, who preached here at our 150th celebration. He once again is going to have to step up in a situation he's done way too many times. Pray for him, for wisdom, strength, but pray for unity. And my prayer for them, for us, for the SBC itself, we must pray that Satan is bound. That Satan is bound in the name of Jesus Christ. And not allowed to hinder the work of Jesus Christ. If the Christians pray that, Satan has no authority. Amen? But please pray for the convention. Prayer covers fix everything. Amen? Let us pray. No, we already prayed. Did we pray? Oh, yeah, we're doing the Lord's Supper. We'll pray here.
Lord said, Paul said, if we approach this table, we're afraid our hearts in the right place with God. Well, we've talked about all that. So let's pray even now. You pray to yourself. I'll pray to myself for just a moment. Let's confess any sins in our life. Let's be right with God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, in the name. Amen. Today, as we approach the Lord's Supper, we celebrate all that Jesus has done. Bread represents who the Lord is and all that He was, that He gave to the sacrifice.
Dear Heavenly Father, we pray as we come to your table and remember that great sacrifice of your Son. We pray for the bread that represents the body that was broken for us. Lord, just ask that we remember that great sacrifice as we would partake of your table. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And it comes with the juice. Represents the blood. Jesus made it. Jesus gave it.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just pray for this juice as a reminder of the blood that was spilled to shed for our sins and the remission of our sins so that we can be right through God through your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask a blessing on this juice and our time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
And I ask the question, where would you be without the blood of Jesus? Lost? No future, no hope, no joy, no love, bound for hell itself. But because of the blood of Jesus Christ, because of what he did on Calvary, because of his life, our future is full of joy, hope, peace for all eternity. If we know Jesus is our Savior, my prayer is you do not only celebrate Jesus, please experience it. Know who he is. And remind yourself daily that Jesus is the Lord. We are the humblest. And we pray. Just took the cup and blessed and he passed it and said, this is my blood, which is shed for you. The new covenant. Boy, we are grateful for the new covenant. Lord, we're grateful, thankful, and we praise your holy name today. Remind us every day, starting with me as the shepherd, to be kind, compassionate, caring, quick to forgive, quick to think, slow to speak. We praise you and our thoughts after we deserve. And we praise you. Amen. All right, we're going to stand and sing. When we did the program last week, Nita and I said, let them have their joy and sing Blessed Be the Child. Let them have that song. So guess what? Today is your day. Amen.
And Nita said,
no problem.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've come and been able to worship you, Lord. We just pray that we were able to, everyone was able to put aside the circumstances of the world and focus on you. And may, Lord, we ask, our prayer is that we continue to be able to focus on you as we go out in the world, and the world, will, things will happen. But Lord, pray that we would always turn and focus on you to help us through everything that life will give us, that Satan might throw in front of us. And Lord, we do lift up our Maryland Delaware Baptist Convention. Be with Tom Stoll and the many, many good people there, Lord, and just prepare them for everything you have for them to go forward and through all this, get the victory, Lord, for you and for you. Honor. Pray that there's another person that you will send to be their leader going forward. And Lord, we know you are in control, and you have control, and you're working things out for the good. And we just ask your blessing to be upon them. Lord, just be with us as we go out and keep us safe and healthy. Allow us to be able to share your good grace and the gospel with others that need to hear that. And Lord, just bless us and allow us to return to your house again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Two representatives. That's beautiful. So break for both of them, please.